models, with specific applications to machine learning and data mining algorithms. He has served as a co-editor for several journals. He has also served as a program co-chair of several workshops. He has published over 50 journal and conference publications. And his research has been disseminated in several software, including the MVAPICH2, and communication runtime on extreme scale and machine learning toolkit, MATEC. He will be talking about that in the afternoon. So he's an alumni of OSU from the Northern. So let's try to hear from Abhinav. He will be talking about building cooler.
So thanks for the kind introduction. As Dr. Pandit mentioned in the morning, MVAPICH is already very cool, and I completely agree. So I said, let's make it cooler. And this is the work that we did over the last summer, and I'll talk about that. But before I get into that, let's talk about something really important. And to me, as Adam mentioned about national championship, to me, the most important game is the so to me, this was actually the most important game of the year. We got no chance whatsoever when we played against Alon and the Sugar Bowl and the King of the SEC, and winning against them was actually the high point for the Sugar Bowl for me, and most likely for all of us. And the key part over here is undisputed champions. Right? This is the first time it's happened. And just like MVAPICH is an undisputed leader in the API, or InfiniBand and Rocky, similarly, I agree. It's almost coincidental, but very interesting that we have a disputed champion as the first undisputed champion in basketball. And then something really interesting happened afterwards. In Michigan, we got a new coach, Jim Harbaugh, who's the coach in San Francisco 49ers, and March of campus for November 28, 2015. When we have the game at Michigan, so before I go into the details of the work that we did, I would like to acknowledge the folks who actually did it. So 2 years back, I came here and gave a talk at MUG, and all I had at that point was an idea about how to make energy efficient and manage. And really what I had was nightmare at that point of time, and then Akshay was actually the one who actually did most of the work, almost all of the work, in actually taking the idea, refining it, and turning it into real software, is the one who actually should be credited for the success of this project. There were lots of other contributors to this work, Adit, Nathan had been enough, Karapan himself, Dan and Aksha worked extremely hard in this time. In fact, he worked so hard in the internship, he could no longer tell what whether it is at the end of the school. This is Aksha coming out of the period of pressing here at the end of the school. But he worked really hard, and I feel kind of guilty that I actually played more than I thought during this internship. Okay. So let's get to some motivation of this work. So, lots of applications actually fall into the category of what we define as an integrated category, and the compute and communication patterns, temporal and integrated. So, what an application writer thinks is, or hopes is, that his application is spending most of the time in compute, which is shown over here with the gray bar. And slack, which is the time which it's essentially spending in MVR, which he hopes is something very unique. Now, what he thinks is really happening in the system is his application is spending some good work in compute, but it's probably spending more time in actual communication than what he expects. So again, these two applications are still iterative, because it's gone across multiple iterations, and temporal because time spent in communication is almost similar across iterations, multiple processes. I show here with an example of four processes, but you can imagine that this can be extended to any arbitrary number of processes. Now, what is really happening in the system is when you execute this application on a large number of processes, the pattern is essentially kind of become odd. That means you expect an application to show a temporal and iterative behavior, but in reality, what is happening is because of certain characteristics of the system, algorithm, and non-deterministic combination of these factors, the application or the behavior of communication and computation of these size essentially tends to deviate from what the expected behavior is. We call these applications on the execution of these applications on these systems to be iterative but non-number. You cannot really predict what is going to happen in the next iteration because the behavior cannot be actually predicted statically. And then there is the fourth category of applications. The fourth category of applications is the one which are non-iterative in nature. So most of the work that has been done in energy efficiency has been focused on this and this. But what we are really seeing is this. And an example of a non-iterative application is consider something like sparseness, which is the kernel for HBCG. So if we call sparseness segmented by once in an application, you don't really see an iterative execution or a temporal execution of that sparseness. So most of the applications like molecular dynamics, Lulesh, they are essentially designed with this thing in mind, but sometimes what they show is something like this, and I'll explain why this is actually like this. And another example of a non-iterative application is like graph 500, which doesn't have any iterations, it does red first search of an algorithm, and it's non-iterative nature. So let's talk about the state of the art in energy. So there are lots of papers that have been published since 2005 in this area. The work that really bubbles to the top in my mind is adoption. This is the work that was done by Barry Romney and others in Livermore. And the idea is that we can save energy automatically if we understand the structure of the application. So this is how it does. So it essentially creates this task graph. The task period of runtime between 2 and 10 hours. And what it says is, I will slow down those tasks which are not uncritical. Now, this works very well if you have an application that actually behaves temporally across iterations. But the problem is that many algorithms, as well as other factors, cause this adagio runtime to not behave as we expect. Let me give an example. Swing 3D is a neutron transport application from Salamos. And what it does is, consider like a stack of books or a stack of bricks. What it does is it actually executes a wavefront at a time. So if you have a 3D stack of the books, processes are essentially sending them in multiple iterations across two different processes, and sweeps are essentially going on three dimensional space. So let's see how it actually behaves in terms of the number of iterations. I show an example of the 16 processes, which is the ranks over here, and this is the time. Now, how adagio will actually behave in this kind of system. So adagio has some capability for being able to address the non-temporal aspects. So what it does is, let's say it predicts an execution time over here for a task, right? And it mispredicts. So for example, over here, it predicted something, it mispredicted it, so it will correct this. So what will happen is, it will predict over here that the task time should be this much. Now, it actually saw something else. Now, essentially, what will keep on happening over here is that it will actually keep mispredicting, and every iteration will keep mispredicting the time it will take for the task. So, this is just one algorithmic task. And as you will see, the effect of something like that will be actually counterintuitive. The idea was that we can reduce the execution, we can reduce the power of energy without affecting the execution time. In fact, what has happened is you increase the execution. Now, there are other categories of applications which have similar problems. this is adaptive mesh refinement, and this is blue mesh. So let me go into blue mesh a little bit more, because that is one proxy application that has been explored by many vendors and research institutes and so on. So what it does is, it deposits a force at the origins, and it wants to study the structure or the disruption of this 3D mesh. And it uses a Lagrangian method. So what happens is, as the wave is crossing, only the processes which essentially own the data corresponding to the green and the brown are the ones who are actually yield work. The other processes which are in this gray space do not have any work. So that means, so what happens in the current application is all the processes are executing, but they haven't really received any useful work. So in that case, what it happens is all of these processes will be slowed down, and what will happen is that will actually not degrade any execution. So I'll talk about all these statements that we made, especially in the case of foolish, to say energy efficiency with respect to this analysis. Other work that comes to my mind is existing in MVAPICH2. There's a paper in ICP 2010 that talks about connective algorithms on off-grid transfer. But the reality is that most of the applications use very small metrics. They do not use large metrics. So in that work doesn't really get use that much when you actually go and do some of these metrics. There's work from Iowa State on bulk methods for energy efficiency for all and other algorithms, my Davos and Leal and others. And they have similar problems that they essentially are able to only work with in the last year's instances. There's a work from San Diego Supercomputer Center, and it's work done by Laura Carrington and other guys who are essentially working on TMAX GameQ. It keeps a trace of all the trace of the work done by other processes, by processes in the previous runs, and uses that information to see if you can extend it. So the problem with this method is that you're expecting what has happened in the past will happen. Now, why is this problem so complicated? If you look at the structure of the workflows that are occurring, I've already talked about a very small set of workloads, and I've talked about another set of workloads that I've not even touched over here. How do we model these applications? So let's say that you could statically model these applications. Would that still be sufficient to actually figure out which parts should be energy efficient, which parts should not be energy efficient? Even if you could do that, which is itself a Herculean task, it requires a lot of domain knowledge. There are other factors that come into play that make this work as much. So what are those factors? One is OS mass. So these are the two best papers from supercomputing in two different times. Supercomputing 2013, Fabrizio and others, and supercomputing 2010, Carson Hoffler, who is an RD based critic. Both of them actually talked about how OS noise is present in existing systems and how it can actually deviate our execution time over. What are the other factors that come to mind? Our group at PNL published a recent paper at PPOP, which talks about how not only network congestion, but what I say is network contention, which is actually the congestion endpoints, can significantly affect the execution time. Other work that I've done previously, when I was at recent other work from Livermore, SC13, this is actually the behavior of the jobs on nurse systems. How depending on where your processes are allocated in a NASA supercomputer for a job can affect what the execution time. So all these factors, even if you statically model your application, is going to make a huge difference into what you expect to see and what you're going to see. Other things that are coming, and you know, faults are long in high performance systems, and a recent paper by a group again, in IPD15, that talks about how and fault models. So now you consider a combination of these system factors with the performance models, it becomes almost impossible to predict how much time an application is going to spend in accomplishment. So what we are after is maybe the starting modeling is insufficient and prediction is not the way to solve the problem. Now let's go into what an application does when it doesn't have any useful work. Now, as we know, that most of the applications solve those such as Spexy, Trinos, Hyper, all those solvers. New execution models are designed like Xtend, PDF models like Glory, Fortran, OpenStrand, all of them are built directly on the internet. So even if you had another application like NDFS OpenStrand, NDFS BTCS, talk about in the morning, ultimately they'll go directly on the internet. So when a process does not have any useful work to do, computer unit doesn't have any useful work to do, it will be spending time. So naturally, this is the point where you should do all the optimizations with respect to energy. Obviously, you get a lot of optimizations from system architecture like networks and 7 nanometer that is already almost in place. Then the question about this, can we save the energy of an application without knowing what's in the application pattern? We don't want to know what really goes on in this application. That not differentiate this work from all the work that has happened in the past. We do not expect any temporal pattern. That means we do not expect a repetition of the structure from one iteration to the other within an MVA runtime. And the reason we want to do within an MVA runtime is we don't want to change a single line of code as much as possible in any application. And last but not least, without any performance guarantee. We do not want to degrade performance on any application. Then we provide that guarantee. So this one actually the four conditions, the constraints that we had. And happy to say that the what I'm going to present now, from now this point onwards, is a subset of the work that is going to be presented at ISO 2015, which is also a best student data finalist. And Akshat will be taking that forward. So, in order to answer that question, let me talk about a few variables. So, a few definitions in order to explain what we are doing. So, we define three things. Right? So, one thing is, what is the minimum expected communication time for a particular message? So Slack we define as the time spent by an MBI process in a single MBI call. So it could, if you call MBI send twice in an application to the same message size, it may have actually different value of Slack. W is the amount of time, which is the minimum time we expect this communication to. So that essentially can be modeled using very well-known model like Cauchy. But we are going to more details with respect to point-to-point algorithm. There are a few other variables. So gamma is, so let me find levers. So there are two. So levers is essentially the tools given to us by a system to reduce energy. So there, for example, DFS, dynamic voltage and frequency scaling, is a popular lever that people have used in it. Similarly, core writing or blocking mode, as I talked about, is another lever that is given to us for saving energy, because we can actually take out a process and it can be in the ready queue, but it will not be executed till the message comes out. Now, gamma is essentially the overhead of applying a lever. For example, it could be a few microseconds to a millisecond, depending on what we have. Delta is the time at which you can apply that lever, such that the overhead of applying the lever can be amortized over the cost of a month. So what we can do over here is, let's say that you start in an MBA call, right? You're observing the value of Slack. You observe that it has crossed this threshold. Now you can apply the lever and you can essentially reduce the energy. As you keep on going in this MBA call, which may escalate more than what you expected, you can apply all the other levers. So I'll give you an example. Consider a 2.1 gigahertz system, and which allows you to use from 2.1, 1.8, 1.5, all the way up to 1 gigahertz. So you can imagine that you can apply all these levers in an aggregated fashion, and you can save energy efficiency as the Slack value comes out. The right example is the one where your expected communication time exceeds the thresholds at which you can apply. So there, you can apply all those levers, such as lever 0 and lever 1, together right at the start of the number. So there you can save automatically energy efficiency. So the best that I understand over here is, if your predicted communication time is wrong, that is, it's lesser than what you expected, you can actually observe it online and apply the levers. If your predicted communication time which is the lower bound by using logic B, is greater than the threshold to the liver, you can start applying variable stop. So you need a combination of these dynamic and static modeling of NVI communication in order to be able to do best communication. I'll give some examples of point-to-point communicative operations, but won't go into the details of non-dual protocols. So now let's go into the communication protocols, right? So there are most of the messages, most of the applications are small messages. So let's consider sending a small message using the EDO protocol. And that, remember, our target is to be able to reduce the energy without degrading the execution time. So for every MVI call, or most of the MVI calls that the applications use, we have to be able to classify whether it is a false positive or a true positive. A false positive is the one which is likely going to degrade the execution time. So when MVI send is called with either, just copy the message in return. This is called early send completion. It's been there in MVAPICH and MVAPICH for a very long time. Very easy protocol, very nice, that gives high latency. But the problem is, it doesn't have spent enough time in the MVAPICH. So that means it's likely going to be false positive for applying the label. Now think about receive. So receive, when a process calls MVAPICH, receive, first thing we do is unexpected queue. Right? So unexpected queue is the queue which essentially stores the sends or the requests for sends, etc. that come, and a matching receive is another problem. In those cases, you go to the unexpected queue search. If you find it in the unexpected queue, you can just match it and go. Done. The next thing is to essentially do a channel search. So you look at different channels, such as MVAPICH has lots of channels like network, shared memory, other channels, etc. You look for them, and then you apply this technique. If the time I've been looking for network and shared memory messages to come is exceeds this threshold, I can now apply it without degrading the execution time. So you can apply DBFS, you can do co-writing, whatever you have in your system. Let's look at non-blocking messages, because non-blocking messages, lots of applications are starting to use non-blocking messages. They are being false positives, because they just initiate the communication without blocking or waiting for the information. So they are very likely going to be false. So how do we handle, so obviously non-blocking messages are associated with completion messages like weights, tests, probes, and so on. Consider this like to be a circular queue of requests. That could have requests from send and receive. Now what we do is, we essentially go through these requests starting from this point, and we keep on going through them till we either we receive a message before the threshold is crossed, or we don't receive a message. If we receive a message, we reset our timer to the start of the MVAPICH. So what we again want to do is, as long as we can make progress on one or more of these requests, we are good. But if we cannot make progress on one or more of these requests, we just again wait for something like this, and essentially go away and get the problem. Interestingly, let's talk about a little bit about collective algorithms. Collective algorithms are, so one thing I have intentionally ignored is the rendezvous protocols. There are a lot more details in the paper that I don't want to go into the details of that. They're much more complicated than for a 20-25 minute talk. So I have ignored them for today's talk. So I classify the collectors into two parts, unrooted collectors and the rooted collectors. Unrooted collectors are like on-to-all, on-reduction, on-to-personalized exchange, and so on. So now let's consider a ring algorithm, which is used for one-to-one broadcasting. So in the ring algorithm, let's say this process does not arrive and all other processes are actually arriving. This happens very frequently, right? In most of these applications, one guy gets delayed and everybody has to wait for the connection to happen. So what will happen here is that this guy is essentially stuck in the first step. But this process and this process can actually finish the first step, depending on which protocol you use. For example, this process could actually be stuck in the first step if you're using a non-deterministic protocol, or it could be stuck in the second step if you're using a linear protocol. So we can actually use these techniques within a collective operation to figure out whether we should expect a lever to be used in this step of the collective or not in this step. Again, every time the idea is be able to classify a collective operation and the steps in the collective operation as fast progress. Because we do not want to reduce the degrade the execution time with the cost of energy savings. So once this process comes in the collective, then everything is hunky dory because now all these processes can communicate. And the only thing that you will actually see is because all these processes are now added in the collective, now most likely you're not going to see enough slack for energy issues. Another example that I would like to show. So I actually would like to go a little bit very slow on the slide. So let's go with this rotate collector. So let's talk about broadcast algorithm. So the broadcast algorithm, this process has arrived in the collector and it sends a message in the first step of the collector. Now, the point that I want to get to is every process in the broadcast or the reduction tree can precisely figure out the minimum time after which it will receive the message from the root. Because this process will receive after two steps, this process will receive after three steps. So if you have already exceeded, if your minimum execution time is exceeded, then you can actually slow down your process by using one or more set of tables without degrading performance. So you can imagine that you can build other algorithms on top of it, like reduction for the broadcast, especially when you have a broadcast which is hardware supported, so you can do something like on reduction using this sort of. So we have essentially built this nuts and bolts, so to speak, for many of the collective operations, the major collective operations that most of the applications use or the runtimes of the solvents use, and that bring them to energy management, which we call as energy management. I'll quickly go over this. The idea here is we prove that we can bound the performance loss, where we define our thresholds in such a way, and we can also bound the loss on the energy savings. How much loss on the energy savings that we're going to receive because you're doing this dynamic sort of using formulas. But I'd be happy to talk offline about these things if you talk about share the lot more details to the paper than I'm present. Okay. Now let's go to the performance evaluation. We did this on TAC, which is 6200 nodes. And MVAPICH 2.0, that's the one. And we have three baseline comparisons. Optimistic is the current default, where the process keeps going all the time. Pessimistic is the other end of the spectrum, where you always block. And there is such mode provided by MVAPICH monitoring. So you block on every MVI call. And there is something in between, which is the design that I just presented in the last few slides, which is called Energy Aware MVI. We have two power levers that we have seen people use, one is interrupt and execution, or some blocking mode or overwriting, we can use each other way. The overhead that we see for that is about 5 microseconds, and we can achieve almost 66% power improvement using the level as the measurement. We looked at DKFS. Unfortunately, DKFS is not available on any production systems because it requires a user. So we have not been able to evaluate with the DFS, but if the DFS was to become available, we will do that. And we did use power in general, rapid actually measure the power or the energy of the device. We use 10 different applications. I won't go into all of them. So we need unstructured finite element codes, molecular dynamics, low, slow, leaf, boom, deep, blue, algebraic multigrade, GPT, Udesh, graph, and The idea behind this was we can throw any application into this and we want to understand can it save energy without knowing about anything about it. So that was really great. Now, one thing that we really observed was at least one application was there, which essentially we thought was iterative and temporal, but it actually behaved as iterative and non-temporal when we actually executed. So this is the benefits that you can see in terms of energy efficiency. So for example, for mini-FT, you can achieve about 25%, and for up to graph analytics, you can achieve about 40%. The loss in terms of execution time is actually in the error range. 5% is typically considered an error range in many of the NVI applications. So you see maximum is 4%, many times is 0%, 2%, and so on. So the idea is, with 66% energy efficiency, can you essentially achieve So if your application spends 20% time in MVI, with 66% energy efficiency, you can achieve close to 30% reduction in energy. And that's pretty huge in my sense, because this is a very low investment in order to be able to achieve that level of energy without knowing anything about the application. So just a quick evaluation results, I'll go into this important level. And so what it essentially shows is, on the y-axis is a relative energy consumption of pessimistic and EAM approaches in comparison to the optimistic approaches. So this is the energy, and this is the speed up. And this is for 2,000 processes, this is for 4,000 processes. Now, for most of the time, EAM and pessimistic are able to achieve almost same energy. So that means we can almost achieve the same level of energy that pessimistic will provide, which is 90K. But at the same time, not be able to essentially degrade the performance at all. So in fact, in a few cases, we actually seen an improvement in execution time. We talk about it, why that happens. But this is the critical graph. So the question is, it's just not good enough to just be able to see what the state provides. But do you really have a case where you? So consider sweep. In sweep case, you can act, you degrade performance dramatically if you use the business. But EM is almost seeing no degradation in terms of performance. So the key thing over here is, for 10 different applications which you don't know about, we are able to save energy without losing performance on any of them. So we have a hope that if you have your application, you can actually use this design, and a future release of an application will be able to save you easily 10, 15, 20%, depending on how much time you spend in the app without losing performance. Thank you.
So in the case of sweep theory, you got actually worse performance than the pessimistic, where you were blocking all the time, right? Because it ran for a much longer time.
Exactly. Well, for every message, so it's a false positive, because many times when you're sending these blocks, these blocks are small enough, and if you're going to be blocking for each sense, you're essentially going to increase latency from a few microseconds to about 10 microseconds. It adds up in terms of latency.
So I'm just wondering if there's a middle ground here where you increase the spin count variable, where you know you spin for a certain number of times, say like a millisecond before locking. Is there a middle ground between the two?
So essentially, it may or may not work for an application. It's not like it's...
Yeah, it's kind of a black box approach.
It's kind of an approach where... It, so what is the ideal spin count, 10? So basically that's very difficult to know what the ideal spin count is. But the other contribution also is that the static modeling part, especially the collective algorithms, when you look at, we already talked about algorithm personality because there's no space, but for all gather and reduction broadcast streams, you can actually start using a power layer right in start. If you know the time is going to be larger, then it's going to go up.
But you could also apply your technique to find out the spin count for a particular application.
For a particular application, yes. For a particular application, you could do that. But
sir, are you guys interested in doing studies with DEFS?
Absolutely. We would be very interested in doing studies with DEFS.
I think Livermore has figured out a way to run that on our systems. If you talk to their announcer.
Okay, definitely. I could not convince my systems to be able to do it. But
yeah, there's two things. They've created like libMSR. And they're trying to push that actually into the kernel out. So eventually we hope that it'll be in the Linux kernel. But in the meantime, there's a way you can enable it on the little more machine that's the new studies.
But I think
there is the secret.
Alright.
Okay, so next back to Abhinav. So we'll move to the next talk. Dan Brook from the Joint Institute for Computer Sciences and University of Tennessee. Glenn currently serves as the Chief Technology Officer at the Chief Spiritual